Reputable Blue Jays reporter Shai Davidi spoke about the possibility of Toronto acquiring all-star closer Liam Hendricks from the Chicago White Sox. What kind of package would it take for a Hendricks-Jays reunion? We'll break that down on this episode of Jays Digest. What's up, Jays fans? I'm your host, Peter Vryonis, alongside host Nick Gosse. Got a lot to get into today. First, I want to thank you all for the support. It's been unreal. We're on the road to 5K subscribers by Christmas time. We're almost there. It's going to be a time crunch, but you guys have been unbelievable. Thanks so much.
Yeah, it's been unbelievable, and hopefully we can get there. You know, no worries if not, but make sure to hit the subscribe button if you enjoy the daily content. But let's just get into the first topic of the video, which is the main topic, and a potential blockbuster trade could be coming. And like you said in the intro, Peter, Shai Davidi dropped an article just the other day, I believe 1 or 2 days ago, and it said this: adding another offensive piece makes sense, as does further lengthening the bullpen, with Liam Hendricks making some sense for the Blue Jays if the Chicago White Sox chose to switch over their core. Obviously, Liam Hendricks is an elite reliever. We used to have him way back in the early 2010s, yeah. And he's been very good. And there was also another screenshot here saying there's always room to improve and no reason the Blue Jays to stop looking for help now. They've been showing interest in some high upside relievers since adding Eric Swanson in a trade, so that's an area to monitor. And that was a different article, I believe, by Ben Nicholson-Smith, but it may have been Shai Davidi. But either way, lots of rumors going around that Blue Jays are looking to acquire high-end arms, and Liam Hendricks is just that. And what are your thoughts on the potential? I think we touched on it in a prior video like a month ago, but now after the moves that we've had so far in the offseason, what are your thoughts on a potential Liam Hendricks reunion?
This would be a win-now move if I've ever seen it by the Toronto Blue Jays, and you can never have too many arms. That's just the truth of the major leagues. Like, you always want to have as many high-quality relievers. And Liam Hendricks is a guy that the Jays don't have much of, and that's strikeouts in the bullpen. Jordan Romano, he's like 10 Ks per nine, 11 Ks per nine. Liam Hendricks is like in the 12, 13 area. So he is a true swing and miss reliever. He is a righty. The Jays need a lefty in there, like your guy Gregory Soto. That would be the perfect guy to go out and get. But Liam Hendricks, he's been an all-star. He still is an all-star caliber reliever closer, so it would be I don't know what it would take to get him to get a reunion together, but definitely a great piece to add.
Yeah, and we'll break down in a couple minutes a potential trade that I saw float around Twitter, and it's really hard to make a trade around him, especially people in our last video commented about the obviously his contract is a bit of a pretty big one. But again, if you're trying to win now, they've already over the tax with the official signing of Kevin Kiermaier, which we'll touch on a bit more. But here's another screenshot, and this is from Ben Turner. He's basically saying that Shai mentioned Hendricks' name in the same interview, saying that trade around him would be interesting. And this is not the first time that Shai has said this. Obviously, in his article, like I showed, he said that they have interest in Hendricks. But Shai Davidi has been talking about Hendricks and the Blue Jays for the past 2 to 3 weeks. And I don't know. It just seems like a good fit on paper. And I think it would involve one of our catchers, because obviously it would have to benefit both teams. And like you said, Liam Hendricks has been elite since 2018. He's been a solid reliever his whole career. Obviously, he was solid when he was with us. He was not what he is now. But ever since 2018, sub-3 ERA, 2 years, below 2 ERA, and, a little bit of regression, like a tiny bit. He's now into 2.5 ERAs. But like you said, he's a strikeout pitcher, and he's dominant in there.
Yeah, exactly. And it makes sense for the Blue Jays, of course. Like, if you can trade from an area depth like the catcher position to really bolster your bullpen, which Liam Hendricks really helped with. I just don't know if it makes sense for the Chicago White Sox, because the AL Central is a very weak division, and they have the chance to go out there and win it. So I think the Twins got worse. I think the Chicago White Sox, it's their division to lose right now. And maybe the Guardians. I mean, the Guardians are pretty good team, up-and-coming team, but I don't know if they're quite there yet. They were a great story last year. They probably are the favorites to win the AL Central, but does Chicago really want to shake up their core that much and get rid of their closer, the guy that's so important to their team's success? I don't know. I mean, I'm sure the Jays are open to it, but it's all about Chicago's end of the deal there.
Yeah, and maybe if you're getting a catcher in Danny Jansen, for example, which shown a second back, it would make a bit of sense. But like you said, he's their closer, and they would have to replace him or have someone internally to replace him. And this is a trade I saw around, and I edited it a little bit. Now, obviously, this trade wouldn't work right now just from the point of view of our roster spots. We're already pretty full. But this is kind of just gives you an idea. So this is Danny Jansen for Hendricks, Banks, and Lopez, a left-handed reliever. And Lopez, who is, it says starting pitcher, but he pitched a lot of the bullpen as well. You're probably only going to get one of two of those guys. But I wanted to throw both in there just to show you that, you know, the Red Sox or the White Sox do have some relief pitchers and starting pitchers. And I think, you know, Danny Jansen for Hendricks straight up, I don't know if the Blue Jays entertain that fully. I think you're giving up a lot of value in Jansen just to get back a, but you know, he is an elite closer, but they could have just got Ryan Helsley. Helsley, I think is how you pronounce it. But so that would have made a bit more sense. But what are your thoughts on maybe packaging Jansen for Hendricks and another pitcher, maybe a starter or a left-handed reliever?
I wouldn't mind it at all. But it, like I said, it's all about
the White Sox.
How much Chicago values Liam Hendricks and those other pieces that he mentioned in there. So it, I guess it would make sense for the Toronto Blue Jays, but Chicago's got the same problem that Toronto has, where they don't have any left-handed bats in their lineup, and they showed their rotation, it's all righties, you know, so they have the same exact problem as the Blue Jays do, although I still think the Jays are the better team here. But if they get Jansen, I don't know if it's really addressing one of their needs. They have Yasmani Grandal, who's unfortunately declining, kind of over the hill. He's not great anymore. He's in not just declining, he's fallen off a cliff. So Danny Jansen would be a more than capable replacement for Yasmani Grandal, both offensively and defensively. But Chicago, man, I don't know. This is a big move. Like, if you get rid of your closer, you got to go out there and get another closer to replace who you just lost, because they're not rebuilding. They're not rebuilding, and it's tough. It's tough to deal with a team, and you both get better when one of the teams isn't rebuilding.
Yeah, and you're exactly right. And you know, from our perspective, a straight up, I think the White Sox would do a straight up Liam Hendricks for Danny Jansen, just because Danny Jansen would be their catcher of the future, especially if they think they could re-sign him. But the Blue Jays wouldn't do that because they obviously can get more value. So you'd have to find a way to, you know, package Hendricks, especially because of his big contract, with a couple of other pieces, whether that be a prospect or ideally a left-handed relief arm like one I showed in there. And right. if we're addressing, you know, left-handed relief, which is, you know, reportedly need to address and they're reportedly like going after, and then you also get Liam Hendricks, and it makes a bit more sense, but it depends on the other packages because they've declined a trade already. With the Phillies, I believe. Was it Cardinals for Helsley, whoever it was. And very, very interesting. We'll keep an eye on it, and Hendricks getting him back in a Jays uniform would be kind of interesting. But let's just touch on the second topic here, which is Kevin Kiermaier is excited to join the Jays. I have one screenshot for you guys, and we'll touch on another thing in a future video as well. That's something that needs a bit more addressing. But this is Kevin Kiermaier today. So he got officially signed today, 1 year, $9 million, saying, "Hello, Toronto, hello, Jays fans. I'm glad I don't have to contain my excitement anymore. I'm beyond thrilled to be a part of this organization. Promise you I'll care as much as anyone out there on the field. Cannot wait to get this going." He had his interview today, and he also went on to discuss some very important information. I don't have the screenshot for you, but I'm sure you've seen it around, that essentially he was told that he is going to be our starting center fielder and that it is his job to lose. We might have to make a whole nother video on that because that's a pretty big piece of information, moving Springer to right field. But what are your thoughts on, I guess, Kiermaier signing briefly as a whole, and, you know, his excitement to join Toronto, and apparently he might be our center fielder of the future.
Yeah.
But, you know, I can't see Ross Atkins. If a Brian Reynolds trade comes up, I don't think Kevin Kiermaier would be the stopping factor.
Well, all signs are pointing towards him being our everyday center fielder. I have two questions, though. Can he stay healthy? And what does he do when he does stay healthy? Can he produce enough with the bat to where he's not like a negative in the Blue Jays lineup? That'll remain to be seen. But I don't hate the fact that he's our everyday center fielder as stands right now. So I'll say it this way. The Jays really wanted to focus on run prevention, and we were kind of wondering, what does that mean? Like, what is run prevention? Obviously, it makes sense on the pitching end of things. You want strikeouts, you want to keep the ball in the ballpark. That's what run prevention is. But they just traded 25 plus home runs and 80 RBIs in Teoscar Hernandez. Kevin Kiermaier, as good as he is defensively, he's never going to hit 25 home runs or drive in 80 runs. It's just not the type of player that he is. But run prevention could also mean adding a Gold Glover in center field to replace a Silver Slugger caliber right fielder, and then moving a guy who could potentially win a Gold Glove if he was still in his prime, in George Springer, to right field. So that now you have two plus defenders in center field and right field, and it just makes sense for the whole run prevention scheme that you're going for right now. So I'm not mad that Kevin Kiermaier will be our everyday center fielder as it is right now.
Yeah, and again, we could probably have a whole video about this, and we might, or maybe on a live stream, we'll discuss it more in depth because, you know, moving Springer to right, comparing their values, there's tons of stuff we can talk about there. But we might have another video on that in the future, a live stream, but I agree with everything you said. I'm not mad at it, and it is something we'll definitely have to touch on further, especially if they don't make any more moves, because we can talk about Kevin Kiermaier for a while, a lot about his injury. He touched on his injury, so we'll talk about that in a future video. But let's just get into the final topic of the video, which is, pop it up here, some free agency updates for you guys. So this dropped a couple hours ago. Red Sox appear to be seriously considering Sarah free agent Dansby Swanson would allow them to keep Story at second base. Swanson in very good shape. Now, I'll ask you this, because one of my friends asked me this when they put it in the group chat today, and they said, are you worried about the Red Sox if they get Dansby Swanson from a Blue Jays perspective and having to battle them in the division? My answer was no. What's yours?
Yes and no. I mean, I think Dansby Swanson at this stage of his career is a better player than Xander Bogaerts. They're still going to have to pay him a lot of money, though, and I don't know. I don't know if I'm worried about the Red Sox at all, more so than I'm worried about the Yankees or even the Orioles. But, this does affect the Blue Jays in a way, because they get better. They get better if they add a guy like Dansby Swanson. So it's definitely something to monitor. I'm sure they're going to throw all the money out at him because they just lost their star shortstop that's been a Red Sox for life. And you thought he was going to retire there, but it's obviously not going to be the case. So it's something to take a look at for sure, but I don't know how worried I am about the Red Sox if they get Dansby Swanson.
Yeah, I agree. I don't know how Dansby Swanson, I'm curious to see how he'll compare to Xander Bogaerts over the next few years. And Xander Bogaerts is still, he has a few years left of his prime, but Dansby is a superstar as well. On the staying on the Red Sox front, just very quickly, we'll touch on this. They DFA'd Jeter Browns, the centerpiece, along with Verdugo in the Mookie Betts trade. And just very, very quickly, because we're running out of time here, he says, the Red Sox DFA'ing Jeter Browns is another example of why trading a generational superstar in the prime works about 0.01% of the time. And it's true. Honestly, holding on to these prospects is not always the best thing. You know, we're talking about Ricky Tiedemann training for Brian Reynolds and all that, and there's times where, and most of the time, trading your prospects for proven talent is the best way to go. And this is a perfect example. And they basically got nothing back for Mookie Betts besides Verdugo, who had not a very good year last year.
Yeah, that's why. I'm always on the train that you trade your prospects for proven talent any day of the week. But that ended up burning them and didn't do much good. But Jeter Downs getting DFA'd. He's a shortstop. Dansby Swanson might be coming to Boston.
Yeah, it's a very good point, and we'll keep an eye on it, and we'll have a stream coming up over the next couple days. Keep an eye on the community tab. We might be having one tomorrow. We'll have to verify that, and we'll break down everything more. Thank you guys for watching. It's been fun, and we'll see you guys in tomorrow's video.
Thanks.